This was all very theoretical for a very long time, and now we're in the research phase and applications are coming to the fore. It's yet to be scaled, but this is, it seems, a pretty significant breakthrough, particularly in this particular area of banking. You're absolutely right. Quantum computing is based on the theories around quantum physics, and they involve processes that in some ways are quite similar to traditional processes, except that they use, most of them, things called qubits, which can represent both a one and a zero at the same time. So bear with me. What that means is that they can calculate and make calculations at a vastly greater speed than traditional processes, which are either a one or a zero. Qubits can be one, zero, or a combination of the two. It means they can do calculations not sequentially, one after the other, but in parallel, and that just ramps up the speed. So that is the technology that HSBC have deployed on trying to get a better prediction of how a bond will trade at a particular price. And they saw, they say, a 34% increase, which they say is significant when you're looking for margins and efficiencies, which of course investment banks do. That could be incredibly valuable.
So that is really interesting. And I suppose, how do we think other financial companies might be thinking about this? Because we know that the big Wall Street companies have been investing in this. So what are we thinking next?
Indeed. So HSBC, for the context, worked with IBM using their most cutting-edge quantum computer called the Heron. But we also know, to your point, that JP Morgan, Citi and others are investing in the opportunities around quantum computing, because it can not just help improve potentially those market efficiencies, which could be worth billions, trillions of dollars. It can also help with things like fraud detection. It can help with encryption. So on a number of fronts, if the technology matures, it could be hugely material on all sorts of areas that would be salient and relevant to investment banks. And you have some suggesting that in terms of revenues from quantum computing came in at about $4 billion last year. McKinsey says that could reach about more than $70 billion within the next decade.
Yeah, really fascinating story, isn't it? And I really like also in Hannah Fry's documentary series, of course, The Mathematician, and she's done a Bloomberg series, you know, called The Future with Hannah Fry, and she talks about this quantum arms race, and she described quantum computing as being like the discovery of the telescope, i.e. you can just see things in completely new ways. So it's like a step change. But yeah, I was watching the Emmy award winning episode to try and understand it, and I highly recommend it. Anything else we should think about in terms of this story? I mean, HSBC have come out with quite a bullish statement about what they think is going to deliver.
They have. One of the executives telling Bloomberg that this is potentially a Sputnik moment for quantum computing. There are those who will point out that the timeframes to seeing this deployed at scale could be quite elongated. We could be waiting for quite a long time. Look, these are hugely expensive machines. You can't just pop one on a trading floor and then replicate that across all your global trading floors. Not now, at least, because of the question marks about the cost and the size of these things and the complexity of using them. They have to be cooled to a very, very low temperature. Qubits are incredibly volatile. The temperature, noise, any interference can affect these qubits that store this information, the ones, the zeros, or a combination of ones and zeros. So there's all sorts of volatility around that. There are high error rates when it comes to qubits and their calculations, and so they have to adjust for that. So there's a long way to go before these are scaled. Putting a time frame on it, though, is difficult, but this is clearly a significant move in the right direction.